session. We have two talks, and in between we have a discussion. And so I'll let you take it away.
Yeah. Thank you for, I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me here. So I'm going to present this work that I've done together with these people here, Mario Alvin, Carol Morgan, Kostas Tsatsikokoulakis, Annabelle McIver, and Jeffrey Smith. So let me tell you briefly what this talk is going to be about. So it's going to be about quantitative information flow, which is a way to measure the leakage of sensitive information in computer system. And the motivations for this work is that there've been, this is a rather old field. Through the years, there have been a lot of leakage measures that have been proposed with different properties. And it's not clear which one to choose. And also, there is no clear relation among them. So one step forward to try to organize this field was done by Koff and Basin already almost 10 years ago, because they actually said that, you don't need to choose, because in fact different measures correspond to different operational, have different operational interpretations, so they correspond to different kind of adversaries. So it really depends on the model of adversary that you want to have. Still, it's the relations between them and the models of the adversary is not has not been investigated. So the reason why we did this work on Asiomatic is to try to capture the concept of vulnerability, which is at the basis of information leakage. Through some intuitive and general properties, and also to try to figure out the dependencies among these properties. And in parallel, as a prior work, we had studied a sort of generalization of the notion of leakage, aiming at obtaining a general notion that would have as particular cases the various entropies studied in literature, but also possibly capture also other and new models of adversaries. So we had developed this framework that we call G-vulnerability, where the different adversaries are represented by a parameter. Parameter G, which stands for a gain function, which represents the goal of the adversary and the way he measures his success. And what it turned out is that although these works were developed completely independently, to our surprise, we turned out that G leakage, G vulnerability, is in a sense the characterization of this class of axioms that we have studied. So it's sound and complete with respect to this axiomatization. So this is the plan of the talk. We first speak a little bit about the background, present the so-called information theoretic approach to quantitative information flow. And then I will introduce the notion of the leakage and then finally the axiomatization. So let me start with the background. So first of all, what is a secret? So I'm going to speak about leakage of secrets. secret is can be anything. In this framework, we try to be very abstract. So for instance, it can be a password, it can be a location, or it can be a key, a cryptographic key, any kind of value that is considered sensitive. And of course, we will have a set of values for this secret, which we will indicate by X. And we assume that the adversary has some guess about these secrets, represented in terms of probability distribution, which we call a prior probability distribution. Prior in the sense that is what the adversary knows about the secret before observing anything about the system. I will use the word usually really represent this prior with the letter pi. Now, a system So we want to study the leakage of the system, okay? So the system is, in this information theoretic interpretation, is represented as a channel, an information theoretic channel, where the inputs are the secrets, the values of the secrets, and the outputs are whatever we can observe from the system. So it can be, for instance, the result of a computation, but it can also be physical characteristics like, I don't know, the time of decryption, you know, because we want to capture, for instance, the side channel attacks. So everything that the adversary can observe is considered the output of the system. And normally, this system will have a probabilistic behavior. And the reason is because we want to model, for instance, anonymity protocols or other mechanisms like differential privacy, where there is some noise added on purpose to try to make to confuse the adversary. So in general, there will be a probability distribution associated to any input, which is the conditional probability of generating the various outputs depending on that input. And what is important, as you know about a channel in information theory, what is important is the matrix of the conditional probabilities. So in general, we don't want to look at the physical characteristics of the channel, we just want to look at the abstraction in terms of a matrix. And all the properties that are interesting from the point of view of information flow are based on this matrix.
But P1, I mean, you're showing here dependence on individual xi rather than P1 is a function of all the xi's.
P1?
I mean, you're showing here the probability of one, y1 is depending on x1 and y1.
So pi, the prior is not here. This adjusted.
No, doesn't y1 depend on all the xi's?
The xi's are the values of a single variable, not different variables.
Well, these are different values.
Yeah, sorry, the x1, xn, sorry, okay, it's not, yeah, they are the values of the secret, the possible values of the secret. I also should say that these values don't overlap, so only one of them is valid at the time. And another important property of this kind of system is that the probability distributions, the conditional probability distributions are independent from the prior. This is a characteristic of information theoretic channels. And it's nice for us, this is good news because it means that in this way we can model properties that are independent from the input distribution. So they are properties of the system in a sense, and they don't depend on the data in which the system will run upon. So quantitative information flow, what is the problem? Intuitively, the problem is that we want to limit the inference about the secret that the adversary can do thanks to the system, so by observing the observables. And the reason why the adversary gains knowledge about the secret by observing the observables is that thanks to the Bayes theorem, after he observes a particular value of a particular result of the system, the prior distribution changes into a so-called posterior distribution, which gives the adversary a better hint, a better guess about the true value of the secret in average. So this means that maybe sometimes the output will confuse the adversary, but in average, the adversary will have something to gain, or at least nothing to lose, by looking at the output of the system. So let me give an example. This is my favorite example, is the so-called dynamic cryptographers nets by Chaum, was invented a long time ago. So the idea is that there is a set of nodes, users, that want to participate in a there is an anonymity protocol, and there is a set of users that agree to participate in this protocol. The idea is that one node may want to communicate, to broadcast a bit of information, and they want to do it in an anonymous way, in the sense that the value of this bit should be known outside, should be communicated outside, but the observer should not know who is the node, who is the user that is transmitting this information. Okay, so the source of the information must remain anonymous. So for instance, could be this node here that wants to send the bit b equal 1. So the solution of Chaum for solving the problem of anonymity was to associate, forgot to say that we assume that in this set of users communicate with each other via binary channels, so they constitute a graph. And it's not necessarily a full graph, it can be a very sparse graph, but the important thing is that it is fully connected. So we associate to each such edge, each edge represents channel between two users. We associate to each edge a binary coin, and then the coins get tossed somehow. And the protocol at this point works in this way. Each node computes the sum of the coins associated to the arcs that are incident to his node. And then if they are not the ones that transmitted the information, they just compute the binary sum and make a declaration, so declaration to the outside world about the binary sum. The sender, the one that wants to send the information, will do the same thing, but at the end it will add the bit b, okay? And it will also declare its value. Now, the protocol achieves its goal of communicating the value b outside because the outside observer, to know the value of b, will have just to make the binary sum of all the declaration of all the nodes. And the result will be exactly B. Can you see why? Why is B?
The edge gets cancelled.
Right. Each coin is counted twice, because it's incident to two nodes, so the binary sum of all the coins will be zero. So the result will be just the bit added by this user. Now, I want to show how we can model this protocol as a channel, as an information theoretic channel. So the secrets here are the identity of the node who broadcast the bit. This is also called the culprit in anonymity protocols. The observables are the declarations of the users. Okay, so we assume that an external observer can only see the declaration of the users. It cannot see, of course, who is the culprit, and cannot see the value of the coins, and that's very important, so it doesn't know what is happening exactly inside the protocol. And however, I forgot to say that in general we assume that the adversary knows the matrix of the probabilities, of the conditional probabilities. Doesn't know the single values used during the execution, but he knows the distribution. Also, the adversary, as I said before, we assume that he has some prior knowledge in the form of a probability distributions over all the users, so to be that tells what is the probability that the culprit is that particular node. And the goal of the adversary, after he sees the declaration, is to try to infer who is the culprit by using the posterior distribution that he gets at that point. So if we make the calculation on a ring, here it, I take as an example a graph for, that is actually a ring of three nodes, and assume that the bit is one, the value of the bit to be transmitted is one. So the kind of matrix that we obtain depends on the value, sorry, depends on the probability distributions on the coins. If the coins are fair and the graph is fully connected, sorry, and the graph is connected, which is the case here because it's a ring, we get a matrix of this kind. If we compute all the probabilities, we find out that the matrix is very symmetric. Namely, every declaration, for every possible culprit, all the declarations are possible with the same probabilities. The possible declarations are only those, of course, of which have an odd numbers of one, because the binary sum must be one in this case. Yes?
Does the adversary know the topology of the graph?
The adversary, for what purpose? He knows the topology graph, because.
Then I know immediately who placed a bit of one, because I can just look at count the number of neighbors for each node, and if there is a discrepancy between what they report and the.
Actually, no. So we assume, yes, the answer to the first question is yes. We assume the adversary knows the topology, but it doesn't help if the graph is fully is connected, not fully connected. If it is connected, it's and the coins are fair. The protocol is completely anonymous. The adversary doesn't gain any knowledge from looking at the declaration. I can explain you why. But yeah, well, essentially, the reason is that, so I didn't explain how we get this, believe me that we get this matrix, first of all. So if you have a matrix like this, you can see that all the outputs are given with the same probabilities. So there is, intuitively, there is no reason to attribute the more probability to, I mean, except for the prior, of course. If your prior is already biased, then you put your bet on the one with the highest probability. But assuming that the prior is also uniform, then there is no reason, if you see any of this declaration, also for symmetry reasons, right? There is no reason to attribute more probability to one of the nodes than the others. on the other hand, if the coins are biased, then it becomes more interesting, because in this case the matrix is not symmetric. Well, it's not. It's not. The point is that there are some for each. Entry for each input, there are some outputs that are more likely than others, and vice versa. When you look at the output, there are some inputs that are more likely than others, right? So it's intuitive that the adversary will gain something by knowing the exact output, right? The reason why we obtain a matrix of this form, of course, is the more the probabilities, the more the coins are biased, for instance, towards zero, the more likely it is that the node that declares one is the one that is sending the bit. So intuitively, that's the reason why the diagonal here is higher than the other values. Right, let me show you how the prior changes to a posterior. Well, maybe you know this already, or I'll go through it very quickly. Okay, suppose that, for instance, your prior is this one, which means you believe the adversary believes that n0 is more likely to be the culprit than the other two. Okay, so a way to compute the posterior is to calculate the joint probabilities, and you can do this simply by multiplying the prior by the matrix. And then you compute the marginals on the observables, and then depending on the observable that you get, suppose that for instance you get 001, then by applying the Bayes theorem, you compute the probability of each of these nodes to be the culprit, given this particular observable. Now, why we are doing all this? Well, because they are useful concepts that we can borrow from information theory that can be useful for modeling the leakage of information. So there is this famous notion of entropy, which represents the degree of uncertainties of event of a random variable, and we can use it to measure the vulnerability of the secret, namely how likely it is that the adversary guesses, discovers the secret. Okay. And another important concept is that of mutual information that expresses the degree of probabilistic correlation between the input and the output. And the idea is that when you have this concept of prior entropy, that is the entropy of the secret before you run the channel. And then after you know the particular value output by the channel, you can compute the posterior entropy. And then by taking the global, the entropy of the input after the output is in general defined as the average of all the posterior entropies that you get on the particular values. And that is the entropy of X after Y. Now the correlation, the mutual information, is defined as the difference between these prior and posterior entropies. And if your goal is to express the leakage that is due to the system, it's intuitive that you have to subtract the knowledge that the adversary already has about the secret, right? Because that's not the fault of the system. So what we want to model as leakage is exactly this difference between the posterior knowledge and the prior knowledge. And all these quantities, by the way, can be computed assuming that you know the prior and you know the matrix of conditional probabilities. So, So let me spend a few words about this operational interpretation, because it was really an important turning point in the theory of in this field. So about how to use information theory, everybody more or less agreed, but there were a lot of different ideas about what concept of entropies one should use, because already in the literature of information theory there are different notions of entropy, although Shannon entropy is the most famous one. But in the realm of security, so at the beginning people used the Shannon entropy, but was not really convincing. And people were proposing different notions and so on. And finally, Coff and Basin developed a model of adversary and showed that the notion of entropy is correlated to the model of adversary. I mean, a posteriori it's an obvious idea, but at that time it was quite an important discovery, so to say. So their model of adversary is the following. We assume that the adversary can ask questions that have answer yes or no to an oracle. And then we define the particular adversary as the kind of questions that he can ask and the way he measures his attack, the success of the attack. And in general, we consider rational adversaries, namely the adversary will try to maximize the success, the measure of success. So for instance, if you assume that questions are of the form, is the secret satisfying a certain property P? And the measure of success is the expected number of questions that the adversary needs to ask in order to completely figure out the value of the secret, then it's possible to prove that the best strategy for the adversary is to make a search space that completely split at each question. Each time he asks a question, he asks it in such a way that the weight of the probabilities is split in half as much as possible. So for instance, in this example here, he will organize the questions by asking first if the secret is in this set here, because if the answer is yes, and if the answer is no, in both cases, the remaining, the two sets that he has to look for the secret will be two sets of equal probability, okay? And now the measure of success said is the average number of questions, the expected number of questions that we'll have to ask to arrive to a leaf, right? Now, the measure of success, the length of a path to a leaf, you can see that since the tree is organized in this way, the length will be the inverse of its probability, or an approximation of it. So can you see what is the notion of entropy? So the measure of success, remember, is the expected number, is the expected length. And given that the length of each node, of each path from root to node, from root to leaf, is the inverse of the probability, sorry, is the log of the inverse of the probability. Can you see what is the measure? The measure is Shannon entropy, right? Because the expected length is given by this formula that corresponds to the formula of Shannon entropy. Okay, so sorry, I need to problem so we build the RAM. Shannon entropy was not the only notion considered in literature. There were other notions, and in particular, the most famous, the most popular ones were guessing entropy and bias vulnerability. Guessing entropy is essentially considering questions of the form, is this the value of the secret? Is the value of the secret equal V? And the adversary has to discover the secret. The goal of the adversary is to go discover the secret entirely. And the measure of success is the number of questions that we'll have to ask. The average number of the expected number of questions we'll have to ask in the best possible strategy. Bias vulnerability is the converse of bias risk. It is simply the the probability that the adversary has to discover the secret in just one try by asking question of the form, is this the value of the secret? And of course, again, it will try the best strategy. So it is it amounts to the max to the maximum probability of the element that that is more likely to the probability of the element that has maximum probability. And this is correlated to the mean entropy, if you know about it. What? 10 minutes? Oof, I have to run. Okay, so so the problem is, what about the different operational scenario? And that brings me to the second part of the talk. Jesus, time passes quickly. So essentially, the notions that were considered in literature were very limited. So in general, the adversary wanted to know the value of the secret. But there are many other situations in which the adversary might gain something even without discovering the secret entirely. So for instance, you might be interested in guessing part of the secret or guessing approximately the secret, like in the case of location privacy, for instance, or guessing a property of the secret, and so on. And an important example is having a certain number of tries instead of just one to discover the secret. So for instance, this is the case when you try to break a credit card by guessing the PIN code. So this brought us to consider the framework of G leakage, where the adversary is modeled by these G functions, which are the gain function, and represents how much the adversary gain by making a guess when we have a certain value of the secret. Okay, so G is a function from guesses and real values to a number in R. And the G vulnerability measures the threat as the expected gain of the adversary when he makes when he maximizes the such amount. And the interesting point about this is that all the examples that I showed in previous slide can be modeled by a suitable G function. And also the various notions that have been studied in the literature can also be shown to be instances of this framework. Now, this is all what I want to say about G-leakage. Let me pass now to the axiomatization, which is the most interesting part. So first of all, we need to introduce briefly the notation of hyper distributions. So a channel can be seen as a transformation from a prior to a set of distributions so that are the posteriors. And we can often we get something that is not essential, like in this case, for instance, we get two columns which are exactly the same. I mean, sorry, two posteriors which are exactly the same in correspondence of two different outputs. So from the point of view of information leakage, it's not really important that one is called the Y2 and the other is called the Y3. What is important is the weight of the probability by which we get this particular posterior. So what we can do is to collapse this in the same column and sum the probability. And this is what we call hyperdistributions. So in other words, a channel transforms one probability distribution into a set of into a distributions over probability distributions, right? So I will use this notation here to denote an hyperdistribution, and I will use the brackets around one distribution to denote the point hyperdistribution. And the most important one is this notation that represents the hyperdistribution that is the result of applying C to a particular prior. And this is a representation of what happens. So suppose that this is the initial distribution, the prior. This is an example of probability distribution on a set of three elements, so okay, it's a simplex. When I push the prior to the matrix, what I obtain is, in this case, three posteriors with different weights. So the size corresponds to the probability applied, corresponding to that. And the interesting thing is that when the prior is always, so they always form a set of points that represents a convex set. The prior is always inside this set. And it's also the barycenter of the ideal figure, which has these vertices. So let me skip this. Well, this is just to explain that if we have already the prior, if we have already defined our prior vulnerability, is there a standard way to obtain a posterior? Well, and the way it has been done almost in all cases in the past is to define the posterior as the average on the expectation on the hyper. And that is what we do as well. Now, so the reason why we did this work is to try to organize, to try to put to figure out some structure in this zoo of notions that have been proposed in the past. We wanted to try to derive the notion of vulnerability by considering general and intuitive principles. So the first principle we considered was the continuity. A prior vulnerability should be a continuous function of the probability distribution. And the intuition is that if two distributions are very close to each other, the gain of the adversary should be also very close. The second principle is that of convexity. So the vulnerability should be a convex function of the distribution. And the intuition is that if you have different priors and you attack the secret by using these different priors, and then you combine the gains that you obtain in this way, this should be better than combining the priors first and then making the bet, because when you combine two distribution, that always generates confusion. Now, the first result that I wanted to show you is that the G functions are in fact a complete characterization of this assematization, in the sense that for every notion of vulnerability that satisfies these axioms, there is a G function that corresponds to that notion. And then it's also sound in the sense that G vulnerability does satisfy the axiom. Finally, can I have still 2 minutes? And finally, for the posterior, we have considered the following principles: the non-interference, which says that if the matrix is non-interferent, if the channel is non-interferent in the sense that the prior and the posterior are always uncorrelated, then what we get is an if and only if condition. That's the case if and only if the posterior is the point distribution. And in that case, the posterior vulnerability should coincide with the prior. For the other cases, we want to obtain what we call the non-negativity of leakage, namely the principle is that the adversary always gains something from observing the system. So the vulnerability of the secret after the run of the system should be not smaller than the vulnerability before. And finally, the data processing inequality says that if we do post-processing, it's a little bit like what we have in differential privacy. If we do post-processing, that does not add anything to the knowledge of the secret. So if we apply another channel after the channel C, we can only lose knowledge. The adversary can only lose. He cannot gain anything. And finally, the last thing, the last axiom that I want to show is an axiom that correlates the prior to the posterior and says that the posterior should be defined as the expectation on the hyperdistribution. Now, the interesting thing is that if we consider averaging, it turns out that, first of all, non-interference is a consequence. And all the other three axioms that I've shown, namely monotonicity, non-negativity of leakage, convexity, and data processing inequality, are equivalent. So that also justifies the convexity axiom that at first might have seemed not natural. So conclusion, we have, since I'm out of time, I just show the slide, and stop here. Thank you.
So now we actually have a discussant, and so I guess we can possibly ask some clarifying questions, and then we'll go to a more open discussion. So.